Now, let me take you, before we go to the message, this is all still a part of it. The 2020 message, I'll be referring to it next week, but there are about 4 to 5 things I want to point out this morning to you in the 2020 message. The Lord made this statement in the 2020 message: when you leave this world, talking about the church, when we leave this world, you will leave in victory, amen, not in defeat. Yes. And I will give you more in this season than you asked for. That's the 2020 message. Church, things are not the way they appear. We are about to witness history, amen, as never before, amen, this week. And it's going to rock the nation.
Yes, it sure will.
But it will be truth coming forth, and God's going to bring down things that need to be brought down and expose things that need to be exposed.
Hallelujah.
But the bottom line is righteousness will reign supreme.
Yes, it will. Always has, always will.
Another thing he said, there are 2 boiling pots at present, natural and spiritual, and both of them are boiling over. You can go back and read that, you know all that. And the boiling of the church is something we should be paying attention to. I'm not going to read it all because you have it. I gave it to everyone. And then he also made mention, be careful what you listen to. Now I'm saying that to you about the television. I'm telling you, when we walk out of this place today, we're walking in a new dimension of a nation and what is happening.
Amen. Amen.
And if you don't feel it, the undercurrent, then you just are not with it. We're to guard our words carefully. We speak the word of God. But this is the season. This is the one I want to point out to you. This is a season to open your mouth on God's behalf, because he's coming soon. And that's the number one thing he's saying to us, to speak the word of God and bring anyone into the kingdom that you possibly can. And said worship is his weapon of choice, which you already know. And he said he wanted to bring forth, I'm reading from the 2020 message, a spiritual revolution. I don't know if you caught it, that's why I'm pointing it out again, in this nation, to save a remnant, and through the remnant deposit a seed of my gospel in the earth that will sprout and bring forth a harvest in the time of tribulation. Everybody's looking for a harvest. Everybody's looking for a great outpouring. We overlook in the period of tribulation. We are watching the waves of tribulation already, but the church is going to leave in victory because righteousness is going to reign. Now you can put those together, you know, but there are a lot of prophets and a lot of folks who are saying things, and a lot of things that are being said, the prophecies that are going forth are really things that will be taking place. And there will be a tremendous awakening in tribulation. Difficult, but a tremendous outpouring the moment the church leaves. And then the Lord said, trust me in the unexplainable and trust me in the unusual.
Yes.
Today I want to talk to you about fearless courage.
Amen.
When the Lord first said that, I thought those two words don't even go together. Fearless courage. Because courage to me is conquering the fear. Are you with me? But my goodness, does the Lord know things we don't know. It stands to reason, if all of these things happen in 2020, what are we looking at in 2021? But I do know one thing that I heard from the Lord. That is, go into 2021 with fearless courage. Now, I'm going to try to explain that to you. It's Joshua, the servant of Moses, who helps us understand what it's about. You know that Joshua had been with Moses for more than 40 years. Had a very close relationship, worked very close. And Joshua was at home being number 2. That's a rare breed. Very few people can be comfortable being number 2. Everybody's always trying to inch in some kind of way to be number one. But Joshua is our example here. Not Moses. Joshua is the example. Joshua was not like Korah. You remember Korah, who was envious of Moses' leadership, remember? Remember what happened to him too? The earth would suck them up, hallelujah. But Joshua served God faithfully by serving Moses.
Amen.
That was his job.
Amen.
And he did not walk out of his boundaries.
Amen.
Now, as he served Moses, he learned an awful lot from Moses. He watched Moses' life. He observed Moses' mistakes, the good and the bad. He saw all of it, every bit of it. Joshua, of course, was a type of Christ. You understand that. And he foreshadows the one, in all honesty, who will bring many souls to the kingdom. And he also, the entire book of Joshua has to do with the entering, the conquering, and the possessing of the promised land. Now, church, we'll go into a little more detail about it later, certainly this week, but you're going to come to understand that we, my age group, we are the Joshua generation. And I will prove it to you. And you'll have an understanding of it. The reason I can take stands and know that the Lord is coming. So, Joshua was born a slave, you know that. But yet, he was a conqueror of all of Canaan. He understood the frustrations of Moses. And when Moses needed to vent, he would vent to Joshua. And Joshua didn't fall apart over it. The word says that when Moses left the tabernacle, Joshua would stay. So Joshua learned how to worship by watching Moses. He learned how to pray by watching Moses. He learned how to turn to God in difficult times by watching Moses. He learned why it was important to control one's anger. Because he saw Moses when he struck the rock instead of speaking to it. So in the last chapter of Deuteronomy, just before his death, Moses, knowing he was about to die, did something very important. Deuteronomy 39:4. Now Joshua, the son of Nun, was filled with the spirit of wisdom, for Moses had laid his hands on him. And the sons of Israel listened to him and did as the Lord had commanded Moses. So the last act of Moses at age 120 years of age, the last thing he did was to anoint his successor. The faithful servant, listen carefully, some of you will catch it. The faithful servant of 38 years was suddenly propelled into leading some 2 million people into God's promised land. And God had planned and prepared him, Joshua, for over 38 years.
Hallelujah.
So you have to understand, it took the children of Israel about 18 months from the time they left Egypt and camped at Sinai. From the time they departed Mount Sinai, they wandered around at the borders of the promised land for 38 more years. Oh, they moved here, they moved there, they moved around, they did all kinds of things. But in reality, is that the area of wherever they went and whatever they did, basically, they were on the very border the entire time of what God promised them. Did you get that, church? They were so close, yet so far. Now, it says in Deuteronomy 34:8, it says that the sons of Israel wept for Moses in the plains of Moab for 30 days. Now, the plains of Moab is the Jordan of today that shares the border with Israel. So they were right there. They were at the border of the promised land most of their time. But they weren't ready to go. They weren't ready to move. Now, you remember Joshua, Moses dies. But during that time of mourning, there probably wasn't anybody who mourned any more than Joshua did. I mean, this is his mentor. I mean, this is one who meant so much. This is his friend. This was the man from whom he learned so much. So Joshua grieved. You don't work that closely with someone for that length of time and not grieve about it. But when the 30-day time of mourning period was over, I'm sure that Joshua was still grieving, but it was at that point that God showed up, at the end of the 30 days. Look at Joshua 1, 1 through 9. So after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, that the Lord spoke to Joshua, the son of Nun, and he says, Moses' servant, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now, therefore, arise, cross this Jordan, you and all this people, to the land which I'm giving to them, to the sons of Israel. Every place on which the sole of your foot treads, I have given it to you, just as I spoke to Moses. From the wilderness and this Lebanon, even as far as a great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, as far as the great sea toward the setting of the sun, will be your territory. No man will be able to stand before you all the days of your life. Just as I've been with Moses, I will be with you. I will not fail you or forsake you. Be strong and courageous, for you shall give this people possession of the land which I swore to their fathers to give to them. Only be strong and very courageous. Be careful to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, so that you may have success wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do according to all that is written in it, for then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have success. Have I not commanded you, be strong and courageous, do not tremble or be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Why did God start with Moses is dead? I mean, why did he start with that? You know, it's time to get up and do what you've been prepared to do. Cross this Jordan, and you and all these people to the land which I'm going to give them, to the sons of Israel. Every place on which the sole of your feet treads, I've already given it to you. Not I'm going to, I have. If you keep reading it, the Lord kept saying, I've given this to you. I promised this land to Abraham a long time ago. And the time is now here to possess it. And guess what, Joshua? You were born for this moment, so get up. Shake off your grieving. Let's get this thing going. Let's get moving. Let's do this thing. So it says, shake off your grieving. In other words, get past your complacency. Listen to me, church. Get past your fear. Get past anything that's holding you back from witnessing to people. And he's saying it right now. Now is the time to witness like you've never before witnessed in all of your days. Get past whatever's holding you back. Amen. I don't care what it is. Don't let that fear keep you from it. Yes. Church, this is a clarion call. This is a call from the Lord saying, you don't have much time. Amen. Let me tell you what to do with what the time you have. Yes. Witness. Tell somebody about Jesus. That doesn't mean go knocking on door to door down the street. We're not talking about that handing out pamphlets. We're talking about let your life shine. Yeah. Tell somebody wherever you go, be a witness. If you need to go to somebody and ask them to forgive you. If you've been a nut and you've been an idiot and you've driven them away from God, dear God, crawl back and ask them to forgive you. Amen. And let them see that shining for Jesus matters more to you than your reputation. And your pride. You want them to see that God is God. He forgave you. And you're asking them to forgive you. And I want you to know that God's better than I am.
Amen.
And I need you in the kingdom. And I want you to know that Jesus loves you. And it's so important that you hear. Please, if I've done something to lead you astray. If I've done something that makes you not want to come to the Lord. Please forgive me of it. That's what we should be doing, because time is so short. It's the most important thing we can do right now. Number one, top of the list.
Do you want to know how to turn life's challenges and struggles into victories and recognize that you are truly worthy of receiving what God has promised? If so, Proving God is a must-have book. Sandra teaches that God wants his people to challenge him and prove his word.
I'm looking at God. And I'm quoting the promises of God morning, noon, and night. I refuse to look anywhere else. No, I have new blinders on. I'm looking at God and God only.
You will learn how to apply these principles just like Abraham, who was more persuaded by God's word than by Sarah's dead womb.
I don't know what it is that you've been told you can't do. I don't know what it is your body has told you you can't do. But I know this, it's a bold-faced lie.
Don't miss out on this latest release by Sandra Kennedy. Call today and request offer 118 or log on to sandrakennedy.org.
Prove God! And he kept saying, you know, don't have any excuses. He said, can anybody stop you, Joshua? Because I'm going to be with you. Powerful as I was with Moses, I'll be just as strong as I am with you. And he said, Joshua, you are going to do this. He says, remember the spirit of wisdom that came upon you when Moses laid hands on you. You're going to do this. Stir up that courage that's already in you, Joshua. Pull yourself together and get with the program. Amen. Church, get with the program. Amen. If ever you believe that Jesus was coming, if ever you've been thankful for what God's done in your life, if ever you have not known how to let him know how much you appreciate what he's done, if ever you've known that you were sinking and dying and you ought to go to hell and Jesus pulled you out and you want to shout for it, honey, now's the time.
Amen.
Now is the time.
Yes.
Stay in the Word day and night. Everything's going to be all right. Three times in Genesis, we read that Abraham rose early in the morning. Genesis 19, 21, Genesis 22. Jacob, it says, rose early in the morning. Genesis 28. Four times in Exodus, it says Moses rose early in the morning. Exodus 8, 9, 24, 34. The women went to the tomb early in the morning. And this verse is, of Joshua 3 is one of the four times that it's referred that Joshua did things early in the morning. We need to have a mentality of early. And let me explain it to you. It's pertinent to where we are. Joshua didn't drag his feet to obey God. Abraham didn't drag his feet to obey God. Jacob did not drag his feet to obey God. None of them were procrastinators when it came to responding to God.
Amen.
That's what it means to be early in the morning.
Right.
Let me take you even further with it and help you understand. Now, new believers need to be taught that they need to respond quickly. Old believers need to wake up and say, get with the program. So this is it. Be quick to obey him and don't procrastinate. That's what being early in the morning means. But let's look at it a little deeper. This is what he said. Church, in 2021, we need to have a mentality of early, which is simply another way of saying that we need an attitude of quick obedience to the Lord. Life has changed. Life has changed on planet Earth. Things are not the same. And in 2021, which we're already in for a short period of time, we must learn how to obey him quickly. Quick obedience. Joshua, when he spoke to Joshua, Joshua got up and moved without one single excuse. You see it. He moved. It's an amazing thing that Joshua did. But you got to get the parallel. We are sitting where Joshua sat. We're fixing to look at a raging river. We're looking at a raging nation. I'm telling you. I'm telling you. I'm sure Joshua had learned already that excuses don't work. He learned that from Moses. Still don't. Miraculous things happen. You get on board with God early, meaning you listen and you obey. So the first principle that we learn from Joshua for this new year of 2021 is it needs to be a year of prompt obedience to the Lord. It's not going to be a whole year. Now let's go back to Joshua 3:1. Then Joshua rose early in the morning, and he and the sons of Israel set out from Shittim and came to the Jordan, and they lodged there before they crossed. I'll go ahead and read all of it. At the end of 3 days, the officers went through the midst of the camp, and they commanded the people, saying, "When you see the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God with a Levitical priest carrying it, then you shall set out from your place and go after it." Then Joshua said to the people, "Consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you." Okay, Shittim was only about 7 miles from the shore of the Jordan, so they all moved. 2 million people. 2 million people. They walked 7 miles to get ready, and they came to the edge of the Jordan. There they were. So the Jordan is overflowing. It's like a Colorado River at a flood stage. Rushing water. I mean, it's deep, it's turbulent. They were looking as they sat. They were sitting on the shoreline looking at the flood, staring at it. They'd gone as far as they could go, and I'm telling you, it looked impossible where they were. Okay, we came, here we are. We can't get across this. We'll have to sit here a long time. But the only problem was the Lord said, go. Amen. He didn't say, wait until everything dies down. That's what I'm trying to say to you now. Are you listening? So Joshua inspired the people to fearless courage in the face of insurmountable odds. Joshua said, get your feet wet and see what God will do. Keep your eyes on what God has promised you, because he is not trying to keep you from the prize. And the enemy will attack you in your weakest point as well as your strongest point. You'll end up saying, well, this is beyond you. You can't do this. Or, I don't need God to help me do this. I can figure this out myself. Whatever God has put in front of you, whatever God calls you to do in 2021, hear me, it's true. You can't do it, and it is beyond you.
Amen.
So don't try to be Superman or Superwoman. God's going to lead you. God says, I'm with you, and we're going to do this thing together. Please get your feet wet. I mean, that's what God's saying. Please just get your feet wet. In the coming days, church, we may face what looks like insurmountable odds in this nation. But the message of Joshua to us at this new year is, you can act as fearlessly and as courageously as he did, because you have more than he had and Moses had. You got the Holy Spirit living inside of you. We got all of that from one verse, Joshua. Let's move on. Then he said, I read it to you a while ago, so we don't have to go back. He said, at the end of 3 days. Now, why did they sit there for 3 days? They were not procrastinating. God told Joshua to take the people across. He didn't tell them how.
Right, that's right.
And then he said, we need to build some rafts or boats. A raft for 2 million people. Then the third leader says, what if we send the Ark of the Covenant first? What an idea. Of course, what if the guy he was standing to was the leader of the Levitical priesthood? Oh, yeah, you want us to get in there, huh? But I mean, I can just imagine that. But Joshua didn't even pay attention to that. Joshua said, yes, that's it. Send the ark first, because I remember Moses saying, if your presence does not go with us, do not lead us from here.
Yes.
Wow. So we need the presence of the Lord. That's our key.
Amen.
We need the presence of the Lord to go before us.
Yes.
That's the key. All right. Now, Joshua said to the people, consecrate yourself, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you. Joshua somehow knew that the right thing to do was to follow the presence of the Lord. Then the Lord says to Joshua, this day I will begin to exalt you. Verse 7, Now the Lord said to Joshua, "This day I will begin to exalt you in the sight of all Israel, that they may know that just as I have been with Moses, I will be with you." Now I want you to see a little something here. I said earlier, and I'm concluding, I said earlier that 2021 needs to be a year of prompt obedience to the Lord. In order to obey, you have to listen. We need to ask the Lord to tune our spiritual ears more than we have ever been tuned to Him. We need to spend enough time in His presence to hear from Him and cultivate an attitude of first responders to the Lord God Almighty. When we hear it, first responders to the Lord's call. Moses made excuses. Joshua jumped to the task. When they were called and commissioned, both of them were 80. So was Caleb. And he wanted the biggest mountain, where all of the giants were. And God gave him what he wanted. Look at Joshua 23:14. "Now behold, today I am going the way of all the earth." This is Joshua. "And you know in all your hearts and in all your souls that not one word of all the good words which the Lord your God spoke concerning you has failed. All have been fulfilled for you." Not one of them have failed. Wow. Church, it's never too late to fearlessly and courageously to be obedient. Church, let's do it. There's so little time left. These are the most serious days of our lives. The tribulation's coming. We can't stop it. We can't stop the things that will happen. But we can certainly do our part so that there will be an awakening during that time, that there will be a deposit that we have left of the tribulation. Take advantage of it. Maybe we can quit being arrogant. Maybe we can quit being judgmental. Maybe we can quit being pious and prideful. Maybe we can be humble servants and say, "Oh God, when I go to heaven, please let me bring somebody with me.